They were trained together in their childhoods, and there rooted betwixt them then such an affection which cannot choose but branch out. Since their more mature dignities and royal necessities made separation of their society, their encounters, though not personal, have been royally attorneyed with interchange of gifts, letters, loving embassies. That they have seemed to be together, though absent, shook hands as over a vast, and embraced, as it were, from the ends of opposed winds. The heavens continue their loves.
I think there's not in the world either malice or matter to alter it. If you should chance come in low to visit Bohemia on the like occasion whereon my services are now on foot, you shall see great difference betwixt our Bohemia and your Sicilia.
I think this coming summer the King of Sicilia means to pay Bohemia the visitation which he justly owes them.
Wherein our entertainment shall shake
us.
Don't
beseech you.
We will give you sleepy drinks, that your senses, unintelligent of our insufficience, may, though they cannot praise us, as little accuse us.
You pay a great deal too dear for what's given freely.
I speak as my understanding instructs me, and as my honesty puts it to utterance. You have an unspeakable comfort in your young Prince Amelius. It is a gentleman of the greatest promise that has ever come into my note.
I very well agree with you in the hopes of him. It is a gallant child, one that indeed physics the subject makes old hearts fresh. They that would not crutches ere he was born desire yet their life to see him a man.
Would they else be content to die?
Yes, if there were no other excuse that they should desire to live.
If the king had no son, they should desire to live on crutches till he had one.
Nine changes of the watery star hath been the shepherd's note since we have left our throne without a burden. Time as long again would be filled up, my brother, with our thanks, and yet we should for perpetuity go hence in debt, and therefore, like a cipher, yet standing in rich place, I multiply with one, we thank you, many thousands more that go before it.
Stay your thanks a while, pay them when you part.
Sir, that's tomorrow. I am questioned by my fears of what may chance or breed upon our absence. Besides, I stay to tire your royalty.
We're a tougher brother than you can put us to it.
No longer stay.
1/7 night longer.
Very soon, tomorrow.
We'll part the time between then, and in that, I'll no gainsaying.
Press me not, beseech you so. There is no tongue that moves.
None in the world so soon as yours could win me.
Tongue-tied? Our queen speak you.
I had thought, sir, to have held my peace until you had drawn oaths from him not to stay. You, sir, charge him too coldly. Tell him you are sure all in Bohemia's well, this satisfaction of bygone day proclaimed. Say this to him, he's beat from his best ward.
Well said, Hermione.
But tell he longs to see his son was strong. Yet of your royal presence I'll adventure the borrow of a week. When at Bohemia you take my lord, I'll give him my commission and let him there a month behind the time prefixed for his parting. Yet good deed, Leontes. I love thee not a jar of the clock behind what lady she her lord. You'll stay.
No, madam.
Nay, but you will.
I may not, verily.
Verily? You put me off with limber vows, but I should yet say, sir, no going. Verily, you should not go. A lady's verily's as potent as a lord's. Will you go yet? Force me to keep you as a prisoner, not like a guest? How say you, my prisoner or my guest? By your dread, verily, one of them you shall be.
Your guest, then, madam. To be your prisoner would import offending, which is for me less easy to commit than you to punish.
Not your jailer, then, but your kind hostess. Come. I'll question you on my lord's tricks and yours when you were boys. You were pretty lordings then.
We were, fair queen. Two lads that thought there was no more behind but such a day tomorrow as today. and to be boy eternal.
Was not my lord the very wag of the two?
We were as twinned lambs that did frisk in the sun and bleat the one at the other. What we changed was innocence for innocence. We knew not the doctrine of ill-doing, nor dreamed that any did. Had we pursued that life, we should have answered heaven boldly, not guilty.
By this we gather you have tripped since.
Oh, my most sacred lady. Temptations have since then been born to us. For in those unfledged days was my wife a girl. Your precious self had not then crossed the eyes of my young playfellow.
Of this make no conclusion, lest you say your queen and I are devils. Yet go on. The offenses we have made you do will answer, if you first sinned with us. And that with us you did continue fault, and that you slipped not with any but with us.
Is he one yet?
He'll stay, my lord.
At my request, he would not. Hermione, my dearest, thou never spoke to better purpose.
Never?
Never but once.
What, have I twice said well? When was before? You tell me. One good deed dying tongueless slaughters a thousand waiting upon that. Our praises are our wages. You may write us with one soft kiss a thousand furlongs. Ere we spur, we hit an acre. Ah, but to the goal. My last good deed was to entreat his stay. What was my first? It has an elder sister, or I mistake you. Oh, but her name were Grace. But once before I spoke to the purpose. When? Nay, let me have it, I long.
Why, that was when 3 crabbed months soured themselves to death ere I could make thee open thy right hand and clap thyself my love. Then didst thou utter, I am yours forever. Oh,
'tis grace indeed. Why, love you now, I have spoke to the purpose twice. The one forever earned a royal husband. The other, for some while, a friend.
Too hot. Too hot. To mingle friendship far as mingling bloods. A tremacord is on me. My heart dances, but not for joy. Not joy. This entertainment may a free face put on. May, I grant. But to be peddling palms and pinching fingers, as now they are, and making practiced smiles as in a looking glass. Oh, that is entertainment my bosom likes not, nor my brows. Mamilius, art thou my boy?
I, my good lord.
There's my flock-up. What? Smutch thy nose. They say it is a copy out of mine. Come, Captain. We must be neat. Not neat, but cleanly, Captain. Still virginally upon his palm. How now, you want a calf? Art thou my calf?
Yes, if you will, my lord.
I want a rough patch and the shoots that I have to be full like me. But they say we are almost as like as eggs. Women say so, they will say anything. But were they false as wind as water, yet were it true to say this boy were like me? Come, Sir Fake, look on me with your welkin eye. Sweet villain, most dearest, my collop. Can that be? May it be? Affection, thy intention stabs the center. Thou dost make possible things not so held. Communicates with dreams. How can this be? But what's unreal, coact your heart. Thou mayest co-join with something, and thou dost. And that beyond commission. And I find it, and that's an infection of my brains and hardening of my brows.
Means to say.
Something seems unsettled.
How, my lord? What cheer? I was with you, best brother.
You look as if you held a brow of much distraction. Are you moved, my lord?
No, in good earnest. Now sometimes nature betrays its folly, its tenderness, makes itself a pastime to harder bosoms. Looking on the lines of my boy's face, the thoughts I did recoil these many years and saw myself. How like the thought I then was to this colonel, this squash, this gentleman. My honest friend, will you take eggs for money?
No, my lord. Oh, what?
You will. Happy man be his dole. Ah!
as we do seem to be of ours.
If at home, sir, he's all my exercise, my mirth, my matter, now my sworn friend, and then my enemy, my parasite, soldier, statesman, all. He makes a July's day as short as December, and, with his varying childness, cures in me thoughts that would thick my blood.
So stands the squire, office with me. We two will walk, my lord, lead you to your braver steps. Hermione, now thou lovest us shown our brother's welcome, let what is dear in Sicily be cheap. Next to thyself and my young rover, he's a parent to my heart.
If you would seek us, we are yours in the garden. Shall attend you there?
Oh, to your own beds dispose you. You'll be found, be you beneath the sky. I'm angry now, but you perceive me not how I give a line. How she holds up the neb, the bill to him, arms her with the boldness of a wife to her allowing husband. Gone already! Go, playboy, play.
My mother plays, and I play too. But so disgrace apart, whose issue will hiss me to my grave. Contempt and clamor will be my knell. Go, playboy, play.
There have been, or I am much deceived, cuckolds ere now. Many a man there is, holds his wife by the arm, little thinks she has been sluiced in his absence, and his pond fished by his next neighbor, by Sir Smile, his neighbor. Nay, there's comfort in it. Should all despair that have revolted wives, attempt the mankind would hang themselves.
Physic for it. There's none. It is a body planet that will strike which is predominant. And 'tis powerful. Think it. From east, west, north, and south. Be it concluded, no barricado for a belly. Know it. It will let in and out the enemy with bag and baggage. Many thousand uns have the disease and feel it not. What? How now, boy?
I am like you, they say.
Aye. That's some comfort. What, Camilla there?
Aye, my good lord.
Go play, Mamilius. Thou art an honest man. Camillo, this great sir will yet stay longer.
Oh, you had much ado to make his anchor hold. When you cast out,
it still came home.
Bit snowed?
He would not hear your petitions. Made his business more material.
This proceedeth. They're here with me already, whispering, rounding. Cecilia is and so forth. How came Camillo that he did say?
Got the good queen's intrigue.
Happy queen's bid. Good should be pertinent, but so it is not. Was this taken by any understanding paper thine? For thy conceit is soaking, will draw in more than the common blocks.
Lower messes, perchance, are to this business purblind.
Say.
Business, my lord? I think most understand. Bohemia stays here longer.
Aye, why?
To satisfy your highness and the entreaties of our most gracious mistress.
Satisfy. The entreaties of your mistress. Satisfy. But that suffice. I have trusted thee, Camillo, all the nearest things to my heart. But we have been deceived. In my integrity, deceived in that which seems so.
Be it forbid, my lord.
To bite on it, thou art not honest. Or if thou inclinest that way, thou art a coward. Or else a servant grafted in my serious trust and therein negligent. Or else a fool that seest the game played home, the rich stake drawn and takes it all for jest.
By gracious lord, I may be negligent, foolish, and fearful. In every one of these, no man is free, but that his negligence, his folly, fear, among the infinite doings of the world sometimes puts forth. In your affairs, my lord, if ever I were willful negligent, it was my folly. If ever industriously I played the fool, it was my negligence, not weighing well the end. If ever fearful to do a thing where I, the issue, doubted, whereof the execution did cry out against the non-performance, 'twas a fear which oft infects the wisest. These, my lord, are such allowed infirmities that honesty is never free of.
Oh, but beseech your grace, be plainer with me. Let me know I trespass by his own visage. If I then deny it, 'tis none of mine.
Have not you seen, Camilla? Well, that's past doubt you have, or your eyeglass is thicker than a cuckold's horn. Or heard, for to a vision so apparent, rumor cannot be mute. Or thought, for cogitation resides not in that man that does not think. My wife is slippery, if thou wilt confess. Or else be impudent and be negative to have nor eyes nor ears nor thoughts. Then say, my wife's a hobby horse, deserves a name as rank as any flax wench that puts to before her troth plight. Say it and justify it.
No, I would not be a stander-by to hear my sovereign mistress clouded so, without my present vengeance taken. Shrew my heart, you never did speak what did become you less than this.
Is whispering nothing? Is leaning cheek to cheek? Is meeting noses? Kissing with inside lip? Stopping the career of laughter for the sigh? Horsing foot on foot? Skulking in corners? Wishing clocks more swift? Hours, minutes, noon, midnight, and all eyes blind, but theirs only, that would unseen be wicked. Is this nothing? Well, then the world and all that's in it is nothing. The covering sky is nothing. Bohemian nothing, my wife is nothing, nor nothing of these nothings. If this be nothing,
good my lord, be cured of this diseased opinion. And betimes, for 'tis most dangerous,
say be. It's true!
No, no, my lord.
It is! You lie. You lie. I said thou liest, Camillo, and I hate thee. Pronounce thee a gross lout, a mindless slave, that canst with thine eye that once see good and evil and claim to them both.
Well, my wife's liver, infected as her life, she would not live the running of one glass.
Who does infect her?
Why, he that wears her like a medal. Hanging about his neck.
Bohemia! Who, if I had servants true about me, they would do that, which should undo more doing.
Aye, and thou, his cupbearer, mightst bespice a cup to give mine enemy a lasting wink, which draft and me were cordial.
My lord, I could do this. I cannot believe this crack to be in my dread mistress so sovereignly being armed.
Make that thy question and go rot. Dost think I am so muddy, so unsettled, to appoint myself in this vexation, sully the purity and whiteness of my sheets, give scandal to the blood of a prince, who I do think is mine, and love as mine, without right moving to it? Would I do this? Could man so blench?
I must believe you. I do. And we'll fetch off Bohemia for it. Provided that, when he's removed, you will take again your queen as yours at first, even for your son's sake.
Thou dost advise me even as mine own course was set down. I'll put no blemish on her honor.
None!
Go then. And with a countenance as clear as friendship wears at feast, keep with Bohemia and with your queen. I am his cupbearer. If from me he have wholesome beverage, account me not your servant.
This is all. Do it.
Thou hast the one half of my heart. Do it not. Thou splits thine own.
I'll do it, my lord.
I will seem friendly, as thou hast advised me.
No! Oh, miserable lady! But for me, what case stand I in? I must be the poisoner of good Polixenes. And my ground to do it is the obedience to a master who, in rebellion with himself, will have all that are his so too. To do this deed, promotion follows. If I could find example of thousands that have struck anointed kings and flourished after I not do it. But since no brass, no stone, no parchment bears not one, let villainy itself forswear it. I must forsake the court. To do it, oh no, is certain to be a breakneck. Happy star, rain now. Here comes Bohemia.
This is strange. He thinks my favorite here begins to warp, not speak. Good day, Camillo.
Hail, most royal sir.
What is the news at the court?
None rare, my lord.
The king hath on him such a countenance as he had lost a province, and a region loved as he loves himself. Even now I met him with customary compliment, when he, wafting his eye to the contrary, and falling a lip of much content, speeds by me, and so leaves me to consider what is breeding, the changes thus his manners.
I dare not know, my lord.
How? Dare not? Do not? Do you know and dare not? Be intelligent to me, 'tis thereabouts. For to yourself, what you do know, you must, and cannot say you dare not. Good Camillo, your changed complexions are to me a mirror, which shows me mine changed too. For I must be a party in this alteration, finding myself thus altered with it.
There is a sickness which puts some of us in distemper, and I cannot name the disease. It is caught of you that yet are well.
How? Caught of me? Make me not sighted like the basilisk. I have looked on thousands who have sped the better by my regard, but killed none so. Camillo, as you are suddenly a gentleman, I beseech you, if you know aught that does behoove my knowledge thereof to be...
I may not answer.
A sickness caught of me. And yet, I well. I must be answered. Dost thou hear, Camillo? I conjure thee, by all the parts of man that honor does acknowledge, that thou declare what incidency thou dost guess of harm is creeping toward me. How far off, how near, which way to be prevented and to be served, how best to bear it?
I will tell thee, for I am charged in honor, and by him that I think honorable. Therefore, mark my counsel, which must be followed even as swiftly as I need to utter it. For both yourself and me cry lost, and so good night.
On, good Camillo.
I am appointed him to murder you.
By whom, Camillo?
By the king.
For what?
He thinks. Nay. In all confidence, he swears, as he has seen it, that you have touched his queen forbiddingly. How should this grow? I know not. But 'tis better to avoid what's grown than to question how 'tis born. Therefore, if you dare trust my honesty, away tonight.
I know not what may fall. I like it not. How can this be?
Be not uncertain, for by the honor of my parents, I have spoken truth, which if you seek to prove, I dare not stand by. Nor will you be safer than one condemned by the king's own mouth.
I do believe thee. I saw his heart in his face. This jealousy's a precious creature. As she's rare, must it be great. As he is mighty, must it be violent. And as he does believe, he is dishonored by a man that ever professed to him. Revenges must in that be made more bitter. Fear or shame me. Good expedition be, my friend, and comfort the gracious queen. Part of his theme, but nothing of his ill-tained suspicion.
To your followers, I will whisper the business, and by twos and threes, at several posterns, clear them of the city. For myself, I put my fortunes to your service, I hear by this discovery lost.
Be pilot to me. My ships are ready, and my people did expect my hence departure 2 days ago. Come, Camillo. I will respect thee as a father if thou bearest my life off. Hence, let us avoid!
Oh.
love you better.
And why so, my lord?
Not but because your brows are black.
Oh.
Your black brows, they say, become sun, woman best. So that there not be too much hair there, but rather in a semicircle or a half moon drawn with a pen.
Who taught you this?
I learned it out of women's faces. Pray now, what color are your eyebrows?
Blue, my lord.
Nay, that's a lock. I have seen a lady's nose that has been blue, not her eyebrows.
Harky! The queen, your mother, rounds apace. We shall soon present our services to a fine new prince one of these days. Then you'd launch with us if we would have you. She is spread of late into goodly bulk. Good time, encounter her.
What wisdom stirs amongst you? Come, sir, I am now for you again. Pray you sit by us and tell us a tale.
Merry or sad shall it be?
As merry as you will.
A sad tale's best for winter. I heard of sprites and goblins.
Let's have that, good sir. Come on, sit down and do your best to frighten me with your sprites. You're powerful at it.
There was a man.
Was he met there? His train, Camillo, with him. I eyed them even to their ships.
Dwelt by a churchyard.
Nay, come, sit down, then on.
I will tell it softly, so yonder crickets shall not hear it.
Come on, then, give it to me in mine ear.
Camillo was his helping, his pander. There is a plot against my life, my crown. All's true that is mistrusted. That false villain whom I employed was pre-employed by him. How blessed am I in my just censure, in my true opinion. Alack for lesser knowledge, how accursed to be so blessed. There may be in the cup a spider steeped, but one may drink to part yet partake no venom, for his knowledge is not infected. But if one present the abhorred ingredient to his eye, make known how he hath drunk, he cracks his gorge, his sides with violent hefts. I have drunk and seen a spider. Give me the boy! I granted it under you. Though he doth bear some signs of me, yet you have too much blood in him.
What is this, sport?
Bear the boy hence. He shall not come about her. Away with him!
No! No!
Herself and that she's big with. For 'tis Polixenes has made thee swell thus.
But I should say he has not. And I'll be sworn you would believe my saying, however you leave to the neighbor.
You, my lords, look on her. Mark her well. Be but about to say she is a goodly lady, and the justice of your hearts will thereto add, 'tis pity she's not honest. But be it known from him that has most cause to grieve it should be, she's an adulteress.
Should a villain say so? The most replenished villain in the world, he were as much more villain. You, my lord, do but mistake.
You have mistook, my lady, Polixenes for Leontes. I have said she's an adulteress. I have said with whom? More, she's a traitor. And Camillo is a feathery with her, and one that knows what she should shame to know herself. That she's a bed swerver, aye, and privy to this their late escape.
No, by my life, privy to none of this. How will this grieve you when you shall come to clearer knowledge that you thus have published me? Oh, gentle my lord, you scarce can write me thoroughly than to say you did mistake.
No. If I mistake in those foundations I build upon, the center is not big enough to bear a schoolboy's top. Oh. Away with her, to prison. He who just before her is a far-off guilty but that he speaks.
Beseech your highness. My women may come with me. Well, you see, my plight requires it. Do not weep, good fools. There is no cause. When you shall know your mistress has deserved prison, then abound in tears as I come out. This action I now go on is for my better grace.
Shall I be heard?
Some ill planet reigns. I must be patient till the heavens look with an aspect more favorable. Good my lords, I am not prone to weeping as our sex commonly are. the want of which vain dues perchance shall dry your pity. But I have that honorable grief lodged here, which burns worse than tears drown. Beseech you all, my lords, with thoughts so qualified as your charity shall best instruct you, measure me. And so the king's will be performed.
Go! Do our bidding! Hence!
Do, my lord. I never wished to see you sorry. Now I trust I shall.
Beseech your highness, call the queen again.
Be certain what you do, sir, lest your justice through violence, in the which the three great ones suffer, yourself, your queen, your son.
For her, my lord, I dare my life lay down, and will do it, sir, if it please you to accept it, that the queen is spotless in the eyes of heaven, and to you, I mean in this which you accuse her.
If it proves she's otherwise, I'll keep my stable where I want my wife. No further trust her. For every inch of woman in the world, aye, every dram of women's flesh is false if she be. Be she honor flawed, I have three daughters. If it prove true, they'll pay for it. By my honor, I'll gel them all.
Cease, no more. You smell this business with a sense as cold as a dead man's nose. But I do see it and feel it.
If it be so, we need no grave to bury honesty. There is not one gram of it, the face to sweeten of this whole dunny earth.
Hold your peace. Good, my lord, it is for you we speak, not for ourselves.
You are abused, and by some put her on that shall be damned for it.
Would I knew the villain, I would land there on him.
What, lack I credit?
I had rather you did lack than I, my lord, upon this ground.
And more it would content me to have her honor true than your suspicion be blamed for it how you might.
We need no more of your advice. The matter, the game of loss, the ordering on it, is all properly ours.
And I would wish, my lord, you had only in your silent judgment tried it, without a more overture.
But it won't be.
Either thou art most ignorant by age, or thou art born a fool. Camillo's flight, added to their familiarity, doth push on this proceeding.
Yet, for greater confirmation, I will dispatch in post to sacred Delphos, to Apollo's temple, Cleomenes and Dian. Now, from the oracle, they will bring all whose a spiritual counsel had shall stop or spur me.
Have I done well?
Well done, my lord.
Though I am satisfied and need no more than what I know, yet shall the oracle give rest to the minds of others, such as he whose ignorant credulity will not come up with the truth. So have we thought it good from our free person she should be confined, lest that the treachery of the two fled hands be left her to perform. Come, follow us. We are to speak in public, for this business will raise us all.
To laughter, as I take it, if the good truth be known.
The keeper of the prison! Lady, no court in Europe is too good for thee. What dost thou then in prison? Now, good sir, you know me, do you not?
For a worthy lady and one whom much I honor.
I pray you then, conduct me to the queen.
I may not, madam. To the contrary, I have expressed commandment.
Here's a do. To lock up honesty and honor from the access of gentle visitors. Is lawful, pray you, to see her women? Any of them? Amelia?
So please you, madam.
I shall bring Amelia forth.
I pray now, call her.
And madam,
I must be present at your conference.
Well, be it so. Prithee! Oh, he's such a do to make no stain a stain as passes coloring. Oh, dear gentlewoman, how fares our gracious lady?
As well as one so gracious and forlorn may hold together, on her frights and griefs, which never tender lady hath borne greater, she is something before her time delivered.
A boy?
A daughter. And a goodly babe. Alas, delight to live. The queen receives much comfort in saying, my poor prisoner, I'm as innocent as you.
I dare be sworn. These dangerous, unsafe loons of the king, beshrew them. He must be told on't, and he shall. The office becomes a woman best. Now take it upon me. If I prove honey-mouthed, let my tongue blister, and never to my red-looked anger be the trumpet any more. Pray you, Amelia, commend my best obedience to the queen. If she dares trust me with her little babe, I'll show it the king, and undertake to be her advocate to the loudest. We do not know how he may soften at the sight of the child. The silence often of pure innocence persuades when speaking fails.
Most worthy madam, your honor and goodness is so evident that your free undertaking cannot miss a thriving issue. Oh, there's no lady living so meet for such a great errand. I will presently acquaint the queen with your most noble offer.
Tell her, Amelia, I'll use that tongue I have. If wit flow from it as boldness from my bosom, let it not be doubted, I shall do good.
Now, if you've last words, all to the queen.
Madam, if it please the queen to send the babe, I know not what I shall incur to pass it, having no warrant.
You need not fear it, sir. This child was prisoner to the womb, and is by law and process of great nature fence freed and enfranchised. Not a party to the anger of the king, nor guilty of, if any be, the trespass of the queen. Do not you fear. Upon mine honor, I will stand betwixt you and danger.
I do believe it. Nor night, nor day, no rest. It is but weakness to bear the matter thus. Mere weakness.
The harlot king is quite beyond mine arm. Block proof.
But no thought of him. The very thought of my revenge is that way. Recoil upon me, legend be.
Till the time may serve. For present vengeance taken on her. She, I get hooked to me. Say that she were gone. Give her to the fire.
A moiety of my rest might come to me again.
You must not enter.
Nay, rather good, my lords, be second to me. Fear you his tyrannous passion more, alas, than the queen's life? A gracious, innocent soul, more free than he is jealous.
That's enough.
Madam, he hath not slept this night. Commanded none should come at him.
Not so hot, good sir. I come to bring him sleep. 'Tis such as you that creep like shadows by him, and who sigh at each his needless heavings. Such as you nourish the cause of his awaking. I do come with words as medicinal as true, honest as either, to purge him of that humor that presses him from sleep.
What noise there, ho!
No noise, my lord, but needful conference.
Help! Away with that audacious lady! I charge thee that she should not come about me.
I knew she would.
I tell her, sir, my lord, on your displeasure's peril and on mine, she should not visit you.
Why, can't not rule her?
For all dishonesty, he can. In this, unless he take the course that you have done, commit me for committing honor, trust it, he shall not rule me.
Now, allow you, now you hear me. when she will take the reins, my lord, I let her run, but she'll not stumble.
Good, my liege, I beseech you, hear me, who professes myself your loyal servant, your physician, your most obedient counselor. Oh. Yet that dares less appear so in comforting your evils than such as most seem yours. I say I come from your good queen.
Good queen!
Good queen, my lord. Good queen! I say good queen! And would by combat make her good, so were I a man, the worst about you.
Force her hands.
Let him that makes but trifles of his eyes first hand me. On mine own accord, I'll off. But first, and my errand. The good queen, for she is good, hath brought you forth a daughter. Here it is. Commends it to your blessing.
Out! Mankind witch, hands with her out the door. A most intelligencing bawd.
Not so. I am as ignorant in that as you in so entitling me, and no less honest than you are. Oh, mad, which is enough all warrant as this world goes to pass for honest.
Traitors, will you not push her out? Give her the bastard, thou dotard. Thou art womantide, unroofed by the name parchment there. Take up the bastard. Take it up, I say! Give it to thy crone!
Forever unvenerable be thy hands if thou takest up the princess by that forced baseness which he has put upon t-
He treads his wife!
Oh, so I would you did! Then 'twere past all doubt. You'd call your children yours.
A nest of traitors!
I am none, my lord, by this good knight!
Nor I, nor any but one that's here. And that's himself. For he, the sacred honor of himself, his queens, his hopeful sons, his babes, betrays to slander, whose sting is sharper than the swords, and will not once remove the root of his opinion, which is rotten as ever oak or stone was sound.
A coward of boundless tongue that laid a beef her husband, and now baits me. This brat is none of mine. It is the issue of Polixenes. Hence with it. And together with the damn, commit them to the fire.
It is yours. And might we lay the old proverb to your charge? So like you, 'tis the worse. Behold, my lords, although the print be little, the whole matter and copy of the father, eye, nose, lip, the trick of his frown, his forehead, oh, his smiles, the very mold and frame of hand, nail, finger. And thou, good goddess nature, which has made it so like to him that got it, if thou hast the ordering of the mind too, amongst all colors, no yellow hint, lest she suspect, as he does, her children, not her husband's.
A gross hag, and loathful thou art worthy to be hanged, that wilt not stay her tongue.
Hang all the husbands that cannot do that feat. You'll leave yourself hardly one subject.
Oh, once more, take her hands.
A most unworthy and unnatural lord can do no more.
I'll have thee burn.
I care not. It is a heretic that makes the fire, not she who burns it. I'll not call you tyrant, but this most cruel usage of your queen, not able to produce more accusation than your own weak hinged fancy, something savors of tyranny, and will ignoble make you, yea, scandalous to the world.
On your allegiance, out of the chamber with her. Were I a tyrant, where were her life? She durst not call me so if she did know me one. Away with her!
I pray you do not push me. I'll be gone. Look to your babe, my lord. 'Tis yours. Jove, send her a better guiding spirit. What needs these hands?
You, who are thus so tender o'er his follies, will never do him good. Not one of you. So. So. Farewell. We are gone.
Bad traitor! You set on thy life and thy wife to this. Come, my child! Away with it! Even thou, that has a heart so tender o'er it, take it hence, and see it instantly consumed with fire! Even thou, and none but thou! If thou refuse, and wilt encounter with my wrath, say so! The bastard brains with these my proper hands shall I dash out! Go, take it to the fire, for thou set from my wife!
I did not, sir! Lords, my noble fellows, if they please, they'll clear me on it.
We can, my royal liege.
He's not guilty for coming hither.
You're a liar, Lord.
Beseech your highness, give us better credit. We have always truly served you, and on our knees, we beg that you do change your purpose, which being so horrible, so bloody, must lead on to some foul issue. We all kneel.
I am a feather for each wind that blows. Shall I live on to see this bastard kneel and call me father? Better burn it now, you cursed thing. But be it, let it live. It shall not, neither. You, sir, come you hither. You that have been so tenderly officious to save this bastard's life, for 'tis a bastard's as sure as his head's gray. What will you adventure to save this brat's life?
Anything, my lord, that my abilities may undergo. I'll pour what little blood I have left to save the innocent. Absolutely, all that is possible.
Oh, it shall be possible. Swear that will perform my bidding.
I will, my lord.
Mark and performance is now. For the fail of any point in it shall not only be death to thyself, but to thy lewd-tongued wife. And for this time we pardon. We enjoin thee, as thou art liege man to us, that thou carry this female bastard hence, and that thou bear it to some remote and desert place quite out of our dominions, and that there thou leave it without more mercy to its own protection in favor of the climate. As by strange fortune it came to us, I do injustice charge thee on thy soul's peril and thy body's torture, that thou commend it strangely to some place where chance may nurse or end it.
I do swear it, but a present death would be more merciful.
Take it up.
Come on, poor babe. Some powerful spirits instruct the kites and ravens to be thy nurses. Wolves and bears, they say, casting their selfishness aside, do have done the like office of pity. Poor child, condemned to loss.
No! I'll not rear another's issue!
Please, your highness, hosts from those you sent to the oracle are come an hour since. Cleomenes and Dion, being well arrived from Delphos, are both landed and hasting to the court.
But my lord, their speed hath been beyond account.
Oh, 'tis good speed. Foretells the great Apollo suddenly will have the truth of this appear. Prepare you, lords. Summon a session, that we may arraign our most disloyal lady. For as she hath been publicly accused, so shall she have a just and open trial. While she lives, my heart will be a burden to me.
And the climate's delicate, the air most sweet. Fertile isle.
The temple, much surpassing the common praise it bears.
I shall report for most economy the sacrifice.
Ah. Oh. How ceremonious, solemn, and unearthly it was, the offering.
But of all, the birth and ear-deafening voice of the oracle, kin to Jove's thunder, so surprised my sense that I was nothing,
If the event of the journey prove as successful to the queen
so.
As it has been to us, rare, pleasant, speedy, the time is worth the usant.
Apollo turn all to the best. These proclamations so forcing thoughts of honor mighty, I did the like.
The violent carriage of it will clear or end the business.
When the oracle blessed by Apollo's great divine sealed up, shall the content discover something rare, even then will rush to knowledge.
Go, fresh horses, and gracious be the issue.
Contradicts my accusation. And the testimony on my part, no other but what comes from myself. It shall scarce boot me to say, not guilty. But, if powers divine behold our human actions as they do, I doubt not then that innocence shall make false accusation blush and tyranny tremble at patience.
I've never heard yet that any of these bolder vices wanted less impudence to gainsay what they did than to perform it first.
That's true enough, but 'tis a saying, sir, not due to me. You, my lord, best know, who least will seem to do so. My past life hath been as continental, as chaste, as true, as I am now unhappy. I appeal to your own conscience, sir. Before Polixenes came to your court, how I was in your better grace, how merited to be so. Since he came, with what encounter so uncurrent, I have strained to appear thus. If one jot beyond the bound of honor, or in act or will that way inclining, then harden me the hearts of all that hear me, and my nearest of kin cry, fie upon my grave.
You will not own it.
More than mistress of which comes to me in name of fault, I must not at all acknowledge. For Polixenes, with whom I am accused, I do confess I loved him, as in honor he required, with such a kind of love as yourself had commanded, which not to have done, I think, had been in me both disobedience and ingratitude to you and toward your friend, whose love had spoke, even since it could speak from an infant, freely that it was yours. Now, for conspiracy, I know not how it tastes, though it be dished for me to try how. All I know of it is that Camillo was an honest man, and why he left your court, the gods themselves wanting no more than I are ignorant.
Give you of his departure, as you know, which you have undertaken to do in his absence.
Sir, you speak a language I understand not. My life stands in the level of your dreams, which I'll lay down.
Your actions are my dreams. You had a bastard by Polixenes, and I retrieved it! As you were past all shame, so past all truth. Which to deny concerns more than avails. For as thy brat hath been cast out, no father owning it, so thou shalt feel our injustice. In whose easiest passage, look for no less than death.
Sir, spare your threats. The bug which you would fright me with, I seek. The crown and comfort of my life, your favor, I do give lost, for I do feel it gone. but know not outward. My second joy and first fruits of my body, from his presence I am barred like one infectious. My third comfort, starred most unluckily, is from my breast. The innocent milk in its most innocent mouth, hailed out to murder. Myself on every post proclaimed a strumpet. With immodest hatred, the child bed privilege denied, which longs to women of all fashion. Lastly, hurried here to this place in the open air before I have strength of limit. Now, my liege, tell me what blessings I have here alive that I should fear to die. Therefore, proceed. But yet hear this. If I shall be condemned upon surmises, all truth sleeping else but what your jealousies awake, I say 'tis rigor and not law. Your honors all, I do refer me to the oracle. Apollo be my judge.
This your request is altogether just. Therefore, bring forth, and in Apollo's name, his oracle.
The Emperor of Russia was my father. Oh, that he were alive and here to behold his daughter's trial. That he did but see the flatness of my misery. Yet with eyes of pity, not revenge.
You shall swear upon this sword of justice that you, Cleomenes and Dian, have both been at Delphos, and from thence have brought the seal of the oracle by the hand delivered of great Apollo's priest, and that since then you have not dared to break the holy seal.
All this we swear.
Break open the seal and show the secret to it.
Subject, Leontes, a jealous tyrant, his innocent babe, truly begotten, and the king shall live without an heir, if that which is lost be not found.
Too much believe mine own suspicion. Apollo's angry, and the heavens themselves do strike at my injustice. Apollo, pardon my great profaneness against thine oracle. I'll reconcile me to Polixenes. New wounds. my queen. Recall the good Camillo, whom I proclaim a man of truth, of mercy. But being transported by my jealousies to bloody thoughts and true revenges, I chose Camillo for the minister to poison my friend Polixenes, which had been done, but that the good mind of Camillo tardied my swift command. He, most humane and filled with honor, to my kingly guest unclasped my practice, quit his fortunes here, which you knew great, and to the hazard of all uncertainties commended himself no richer than his honor. How he glisters through my rust, and how his piety does my deeds make the blacker.
What studied torment tyrant has for me? What wheels, racks, fires? What flame? Boiling in leads or oils? What old and newer torture must I receive, whose every word deserves to taste of thy most worst? Thy tyranny, together working with thy jealousies, fancies too weak for boys, too green and idle for girls of nine. Oh, think what they have done, and then run mad indeed, stark mad. For all thy bygone fooleries were but spices of it. That thou betrayedst Polixenes, 'twas nothing. That did but show thee of a fool, inconstant and damnable ungrateful. Know wast much thou wouldst to poison good Camillo's honor to have him kill a king. Poor trespasses, more monstrous standing by, whereof I reckon the casting forth the crows thy baby daughter to be, or none or little, though a devil would have shed water out of fire ere done it. Nor is directly made to thee the death of the young prince, whose honorable thoughts, thoughts high for one so tender, cleft the heart that could conceive a gross and foolish sire, blemished his gracious dam. But this is not, no, laid to thine answer, but the last, O lords, what I have said, cry woe! Oh, the queen! Speak
I'll not remember you of my own lord, who is lost too. Oh, take your patience to you, and I'll say nothing.
Oh, thou didst speak but well, but knowest the truth, which I receive much better than to be pitied of thee. Prithee, bring me to the dead bodies of my queen and son. One grave shall be for both. Upon them shall the causes of their death appear unto our shame perpetual. Once a day, I'll visit the chapel where they lie, and tears shed there shall be my recreation. So long as nature will bear up with this exercise, so long I daily vow to use it. Come, and lead me to these sorrows.
Thou art perfect, then. Our ship has touched upon the deserts of Bohemia.
Aye, my lord, and fear we have landed in ill time. The skies look grimly and threaten present blusters in my conscience. The heavens, with that we have in hand, are angry and frown upon us.
Get thee to thy bark. Look to thy bark. Let not be long before I call upon thee.
Go not too far in the land. This place is famous for the creatures of prey to keep upon.
Well, I'll follow instantly. Go thou away.
I am glad at heart to be so rid of the business.
Come, poor babe. I have heard, but not believed, the spirits of the dead may walk again. If such things be, thy mother appeared to be last night. For never was dream so like a waking. I never saw a vessel of like sorrow so filling and so becoming, in pure white robes. Like very sanctity, she did approach the cabin where I lay, and gasping, as if to begin some speech anon, did this break from her.
Good Antigonus, since fate, against thy better disposition, hath made thy person for the thrower out of my poor babe, according to thine oath, places remote enough are in Bohemia. There weep and leave it crying. Before the babe is counted lost forever, Perdita, I prithee call it. But this ungentle business put on thee by my lord, thou ne'er shalt see thy wife for thine own more.
And then with shrieks she melted into air. Touch, affrighted was I. But in time I did collect myself, and thought this was so, and no slumber. I do believe Hermione hath suffered death, and that Apollo would, this being indeed the issue of King Polixenes, it should here be laid, for life or for death, upon the ground of its right father. Sweet blossom, speed thee well. Here lie. And here my character. And there this, which may, if fortune please, breed both thee pretty and still rest thine. The storm begins. Oh, poor wretch, that for thy mother's faults are thus exposed to loss and what may follow. Weep, I cannot, but my heart bleeds. Most accursed am I by this oath to enjoin to this. Farewell. The day grows round more and more. Thou art likely to have a lullaby too rough.
I've never seen the heavens so dim by day.
Keep it close.
to be so still requires nothing but secrecy. Let my sheep go. Quick, the next way home.
Go you the next way with your findings. Thou go see if the bear be gone from the gentleman. How much he hath eaten.
They are never cursed but when they are hungry.
But if there are any of them left, I'll bury him.
That's a good deed, son. And if thou mayst discern by that which is left of him what he is, fetch me to the side of him.
Very will I. You'll help put him in the ground.
This is our lucky day, boy, and we'll do good deeds on it.
Imputed not a crime of me or my swift passage that I slide over 16 years. Your patience this allowing, I turn my glass and give my scene such growing as you had slept between. The aunt is leaving, the effects of his fond jealousy so grieving that he shuts up himself. Imagine me, gentle spectators, that I now may be in fair Bohemia, and remember well the son of the kings which Florizel I now name to you, and Perdita. Now grown in grace, a shepherd's daughter. And what to her adheres which follows after is the argument of time, of this allow. If ever you have spent time worse ere now, if never yet that time himself doth say, he wishes easily you never may.
Besides, the penitent king my master hath sent for me, to whose feeling sorrow I might be some allay, or I overween to think so, which is another spur for my departure.
Pray thee, good Camillo, be no more importunate. 'Tis a sickness denying thee anything, a death to grant this.
It is 16 years since I saw my country. I desire to lay my bones there.
Mm. Of that fated country, Sicilia, pray thee speak no more, whose very naming punishes me with the remembrance of that penitent as thou callest him, and reconciled king, my brother, whose loss of his most precious queen and children are even now to be afresh lamented. Say to me, where sawest thou the Prince Florizel, my son? Kings are no less unhappy, their issue not being gracious, than they are in losing them when they have approved their virtues.
Sir, it is 3 days since I saw the prince. What his happier affairs may be are to me unknown. But I have missingly noted he is of late much retired from court.
I have considered so much, Camillo, and with some care, so far that I have eyes under my service, from whom I have this intelligence. He is seldom from the house of a most homely shepherd, a man who, they say, from very nothing, and beyond the imagination of his neighbors, is grown into an unspeakable estate.
I have heard of such a man, who hath a daughter of most rare note.
That's likewise part of my intelligence, and I fear the angle that plucks our son thither. Thou shalt accompany us to the place, where we will, not appearing what we are, have some question with this shepherd, from whose simplicity I think it not uneasy to get the cause of our son's resort thither. I prithee, be my present partner in this business, and lay aside the thoughts of Cecilia.
I'll do it, my lord.
My best, Camillo. We must disguise ourselves.
I willingly obey your command.
I want the
whether it be fair, I'll comb my hair and I'll walk the road again. My traffic is sheets. When the kite builds, look to lesser linen. My father named me Autolycus, who being as I am littered under Mercury was likewise a snapper up of unconsidered trifles. With dying grab, I purchased my comparison, and my revenue is a silly cheat. Beating and hanging are terrors to me. A prize! A prize!
Let me see. What am I to buy for our sheep shearing feast?
It's the spring hole, the cock's mine.
5 pound of currant, 3 pounds sugar, rice. What will this sister of mine do with rice? But my father hath made her mistress of the feast, and she lays it on. I must have saffron to color the warden pie. In the name of mercy.
Oh, help me! Help me! Pluck but off these rags, and then death! Death!
Alack, poor soul! Thou hast need of more rags to lay upon thee, rather than have these all.
Oh, sir, the loathsomeness of these offends me more than the stripes I have received, which are mighty ones, and millions!
Alas, poor man! A million of beaten may come to a great matter.
I'm robbed, sir, and beaten. My money and apparel taken from me, and these detestable rags put upon me.
What? By horsemen or footmen?
A footman, sweet sir, a footman.
Indeed, he should be a footman by these garments he hath left with thee. Well, if this be a horseman's coat, it hath seen very hot service.
Oh,
lend me thy hand, I'll help thee.
Oh, softly, dear sir, I fear my shoulder blade is out.
How thou canst see?
Dear sir, good sir, softly. You have done me a charitable office.
What, dost lack any money? I have some money for thee.
Oh, no, dear sir, good sir, no. Kills my heart.
What manner of fellow was he that robbed you?
Why, a fellow, sir. I knew him once, a servant of the prince.
Okay.
I know not for which of his virtues it was, but he was certainly whipped out of the court.
His vices, you would say. Well, there's no virtue being whipped out of the court.
His vices, I would say. I know this man well. He has since been an ape bearer.
Oh.
A process server, a bailiff,
no.
And having flown over many knavish professions, he settled only on rogue. Some call him Autolycus.
Out upon him! He haunts wakes, fairs, and bear pains.
Very true, sir. He, that's the rogue that put me in this apparel.
Not a more cowardly rogue in all Bohemia. If you but look big and spit at him,
eat and run.
Well, I must confess, sir, I am no fighter.
Mm.
And that he knew, I warrant him.
Well, how do you now?
Oh, much better than I was, sweet sir. I can stand. Well, I can walk. I shall even pace softly towards my kinsmen's and bid you adieu.
Shall I bring thee on the way?
No, sweet sir, no.
Then, well, fare you well. I must go buy spices for our sheep shearing.
Prosper you, sweet sir. Your purse is not hot enough to purchase your spice. I'll be with you at your sheep shearing, too. If this sheep bring out not another, and the shearers prove sheep, let me be unrolled, and my name put in the book of virtue. I've seen
But Flora, peering in April's front. This your sheep shearing is a meeting of the petty gods, and you are the queen of it.
Sir, my gracious lord, your high self feel obscured with the swain's wearing. And me, poor, lowly maid, most goddess-like pranked up. I should blush to see you so attired. Swoon, I think, to show myself a glass.
I bless the time when my good falcon made a flight across thy father's ground.
Now Jove afford you cause. To me, the difference forges dread. Your greatness hath not been used to fear. Then now I tremble to think your father, by some accident, should pass this way as you did. Oh, the fates! How would he look to see his work so noble, vilely bound up? What would he say? Or how should I, in these my borrowed flaunts, behold the sternness of his presence?
Apprehend nothing but jollity. The gods themselves, humbling their deities to love, have taken the shapes of beasts upon them. Jupiter became a bull.
And bellowed.
The green Neptune, a ram, and bleated. And the fire robe god, golden Apollo. Poor humble swain, as I see now. Their transformations were never for a piece of beauty, rarely, nor in a way so chaste, since my desires were not before mine honor, nor my lusts burn hotter than my faith.
Oh, but sir, your resolution cannot hold, when 'tis opposed, as it must be, by the power of the king. One of these two must be necessity. Which then must speak that you must change this purpose, or I might lie.
Dearest Perdita, I'll be thine, my fair. We're not my father's. I cannot be my own, nor anything to any if I be now dying. To this I am most constant. But does it say no? Your guests are coming. Lift up your countenance. As it were the day of the celebration of that nuptial, which we two have sworn shall come.
Oh, Lady Fortune, scan you auspicious.
Fine, daughter! When my old wife lived upon this day, she welcomed all, served all. You are retired, as though you were a feasted one and not a hostess of the meeting. Now, pray you, bid these unknown friends to us welcome, for it is a way to make us better friends, more known. Come, quench your blushes, and present yourself that which you are, mistress of the feast!
Sir, welcome. No! It is my father's will I should take on me the hostesship of the day. You're welcome, sir. Give me those flowers there, Dorcas. Reverend sirs, for you there's rosemary and rue. These keep singing and savor all the winter long. Grace and remembrance be to you both, and welcome to our shear.
Shepherdess, a fair one are you? Well have you fitted our ages with flowers of winter.
I beg your pardon, sir. Out you bold. Here's flowers for you. Hot lavender, mints, savory, marjoram, the marigold that goes to bed with the sun and with him rises weeping. These are flowers of middle summer, and I believe they are given to men of middle age. You're very welcome.
I should leave grazing were I of your flock, and only live by gazing.
Oh, alas, you'd be so lean that the blast of January would blow you through and through.
Now, my fairest friend, I would I had some flowers of the spring that might become your time of day. Daffodils that come before the swallow dares, violets dim, both oxlips and lilies of all kinds. Well, these I lack to make you garlands of, and my sweet friend to strew o'er and o'er.
What, like a corpse?
No, like a bank for love to lie and play on, not like a corpse.
Sure, this robe of mine has changed my disposition.
What you do still betters what is done. When you speak, sweet, I would have you do it ever. When you sing, I would have you buy and sell so. So give alms, pray so, and for the ordering of your affairs, to sing them too.
when you dance. I wish you a wave of the sea, that you might ever do nothing but that. Move still, still so, and own no other function. Each you're doing, so singular, in each particular, crowns what you are doing with a present deed. That all your acts are queens.
Oh, no. Dora, please! Your praises are too large. But that your youth and the true blood which peepeth through it do plainly give you acts an unstained shepherd. With wisdom I might fear my Dora, please. You woo me the false way.
I think you have as little skill to fear as I have purpose to put you to it. But come, our dance, I pray. Your hand, my Protota. So turtles pair that never made you part.
And nor for that.
This is the prettiest low-born lass that ever ran on the greensward. Nothing she does or seems but smacks of something greater than herself. Too noble for this place.
He tells her something that makes her blood look out. Good sooth. She is the queen of curds and cream.
Strike it up!
Moxa must be your mistress, Mary Garlic, to mend her kissing with. Now in good time.
Not a word! A word! We stand upon our manners. Come on, strike it up!
Lots both eye and hair, half bushels in packs
take no money of me. But being enthralled as I am, it will also be the bondage of certain ribbons and gloves.
I was promised them against the feast, but they come not too late now.
He hath promised you more than that, or there be liars.
He hath paid you all he's promised you. Maybe he's paid you more, which will shame you to give him again.
Must you be tittle-tattling in front of our guests? Clever your tongue, and not a word more!
I have done. Come. You promised me a tawdry lace and a pair of sweet gloves.
Well, have I not told thee how I was cousined on the way and lost all my monies?
Oh, and indeed, sir, there are cousins abroad. Therefore, it behooves men to be wary.
Fear thou not, man. Thou shalt lose nothing here.
Well, I hope so, sir.
What has here in ballads?
Oh, pray now, gossip. I love ballad and print, for then we are sure it is true. Here's one to a very doleful tune of a usurer's wife who was brought to bed with 20 money bags at a burden and longed to eat addis' heads and toads coppin' up. Is it true, thank you?
Very true, and but a month old.
Oh, bless me for marrying a usurer. Pray now, buy it.
Lay it by, let's see more ballads first.
Here's one of a fish that appeared above water. And sang this ballad against the hard heart's remains. It was thought that she was a woman and was turned to a cold fish, for she would not exchange flesh with one that loved her. This ballad is very pitiful.
Is it true too, think you? Let's have some merry ones.
Well, here's a passing merry one, set to the tune of two maids wooing a man. 'Tis in request, I can tell you.
It's not too far gone. It's time to part them.
How now, fair shepherd? Your heart is full of something that does take your mind from feasting. Shoot, were I young and handed love as you, I was wont to load my she with knacks. I would have ransacked the peddler's silken treasury and poured it to her acceptance. You've let him go, and nothing marched with him. If your last interpretation should abuse and call this your lack of love a bounty, you were straining for a reply, at least if you make a care of happy holding her.
Old sir, I know she prizes not such trifles as these are. The gifts she looks for me are packed and locked up in my heart, which I have given already, but not delivered. No, hear me breathe my life. Before this ancient sir, who it should seem hath sometime loved, I take thy hand. This hand as soft as dove's down, and as white as a fan's snow that's bolted by the northern blast twice over.
What follows this, how prettily the young swain seems to wash the hand was fair before. Oh, I put you out, but to your protestation, let me hear what you profess.
Do, and be witness to it.
And this my neighbor too.
And he, and more than he, and men, the earth, the heavens, and all. That's where I crown the most imperial monarch, thereof most worthy. were I the fairest youth that ever made eye swerve, force and knowledge more than was ever man's, I would not prize them without her love. From her, employ them all, commend them or condemn them to her service or to their perdition.
Fairly offered,
this shows a sound affection.
But my daughter, say you the like to him?
I cannot speak so well, nothing so well, nor know me better. By the pattern of mine own thoughts, I cut out the purity of his.
Take hands, a bargain, and you unknown friends shall bear witness to it. I give my daughter to him, and shall make her portion equal his.
That must be in the virtue of your daughter. One being dead, I shall have more than you can dream of yet. Enough, then, for your wonder. But come on, contract us for these witnesses.
Come then, your hand, and daughter, yours.
So, swain, a while. Beseech you so. Have you a father?
I have. But what of him?
Knows he of this?
He neither does nor shall.
Methinks a father is at the nuptial of his son, a guest that best becomes the table. Pray you once more, is not your father grown incapable of reasonable affairs? Is he not stupid with age and altered mood? Can he speak, hear, no man from man?
No, good sir. He has his health and ample strength. Indeed, the most have of his age.
By my white beard, you offer him, if this be so, or wrong something unfilial. Reason, my son, should choose himself a wife, but as good reason the father should hold some counsel in such a business.
I yield all this, but for some other reasons, my brave sir, which is not fit you know,
no.
I not acquaint my father of this business.
Let him not!
He shall not.
Prithee, let him.
No, he must not.
Oh, let him, my son. He shall not be degreed at no one of thy choice.
Come, come, he must not. Mark our contract.
Mark your divorce, young sir, whom son I dare not call. Thou art too base to be acknowledged. Thou, a scepter's heir that thus affects a sheep. Hook! Thou. Old traitor! I am sorry that by hanging thee, I can but shorten thy life 1 week. For thee, fond boy, if ever I may know, thou dost but sigh that thou no more shalt see this knack, as never I intend thou shalt. We'll bar thee from succession, not hold thee of our blood, no, not our kin. Mark thou my words. And you, enchantment, worthy enough a herdsman, yea, him too, that makes himself, but for our honor therein, unworthy thee. If ever thou these rural latches do his entrance open, or hoop his body more with thy embraces, I will devise a death for thee, as cruel as thou art tender to it.
Prince, and would adventure to mingle faith with him!
die within this hour. I have lived to die when I desire.
Will it please you, sir, be gone? I told you what would come of this. Beseech you, of your own state, take care. This dream of mine, being now awake, I'll queen it no much farther, but milk my youth, and we...
Why look you so upon me? I am but sorry, not afeard. Delay, but nothing altered. What I was, I am. More straining on from plucking back. Not following my leash unwillingly.
Gracious, my lord. You know your father's temper. At this time he will allow no speech, which I do guess you do not purpose to him. And as hardly will he endure your sight as yet I fear. Then, to the fury of his highness settle, come not before him.
I not propose it. I think... Camillo?
Even he, my lord.
How often have I told you it would be thus? How often said my dignity would last but till 'twere known? How often...
I cannot fail, but by the violation of my faith. Lift up thy looks. From my succession, wipe me, father. I am heir to my affection.
Be advised.
I am, and by my fancy. If my reason were there to be obedient, I have reason. Not my senses, better pleased with madness, do bid it welcome.
This is desperate, sir.
Well, so call it. But it does fulfill my vow. I needs must think it honest. Camilla, not for Bohemia, nor the pomp that may be thereat gleaned, will I break my oath to this my fair, fair beloved. Therefore, I pray you, as you have ever been my father's honored friend, when he shall miss me, cast your good deeds upon his counsel. This you may know, and so do I am put to sea. With her from here I cannot hold on shore. And most opportune for our need, I have a vessel rides fast by. What course I mean to hold shall nothing benefit your knowledge.
Sir, I would your spirit were easier for advice, or stronger for your need.
Hark, Perdita. I'll hear you by and by.
He's irremovable, resolved for flight. Now were I happy if his going I could frame to serve my turn. Purchase again the sight of dear Cecilia, and that unhappy king, my master, whom I so much thirst to see.
Now, good Camillo, I am so fraught with curious business that I leave out ceremony.
Sir, I think you have heard of my poor services in the love I have borne your father.
Very nobly, have you deserved it? It is my father's music to speak your deeds.
Well, my lord, if it may please you to think I love the king, and through him what is nearest to him, which is your gracious self, embrace but my direction. If your more ponderous and settled project may suffer alteration, on mine honor I'll point you where you shall have such receiving as shall become your highness, where you may enjoy your mistress. Marry her! And, if my best endeavors in your absence, your discontenting father strive to qualify and bring him up to liking.
How can the... How can this almost a miracle be done, that I may call thee something more than man?
Have you thought on a place where to you'll go?
Well, not any yet. But as the unthought on accident is guilty to what we wildly do, so we profess ourselves the slaves of chance and flies of every wind that blows.
Enlist to me. This follows. If you will not change your purpose, but undergo this flight, make for Cecilia, and there present yourself and your fair princess. For so I see, she must be, before the artist.
Worthy Camillo, what color for my visitation shall I hold up before him?
Sent by the king your father, to greet him and to give him comfort. Sir, the manner of your bearing towards him, with what you, as from your father, shall deliver, things known betwixt us three, I'll write you down, that he shall not perceive but that you have your father's bosom there and speak his heart. Methinks I see Leontes opening his free arms and weeping his welcomes forth. Ask thee the son's forgiveness, as 'twere in the father's person.
I am bound to you. There's some sap in this.
A cause more promising than a wild dedication of yourself to unpathed waters, undreamt shores, most certain to miseries enough. Besides, you know, prosperity's the very bond of love, to whose fresh complexion and whose heart together affliction alters.
One of these is true. I think affliction may subdue the cheek, but not take in the mind.
Yea, say you so? There shall not at your father's house be born these 7 years another such.
A good Camillo, she is as foreign of her breeding as she is in the rear of our birth.
I cannot say 'tis pity she lacks instruction, for she seems a mistress to most that teach.
Your pardon, sir, for this I'll bless you, thanks.
My prettiest Perdita. But oh, the thorns we stand upon. Preserver of my father, now of me, the medicine of our house. How shall we do? We are not furnished like Bohemia's son, nor shall appear in Sicilia.
Oh, my lord, fear none of this. I think you know my fortunes all do lie there. It shall so be my cause to have you royally appointed, as if the scene you play were mine. For instance, sir, that you may know you shall not want. One word.
Ha ha! I have sold all my trumpery. Not a counterfeit stone, not a brooch, bell, and bracelet left to keep my pack from fasting. They throng! Who should buy first? As if my trinkets had been hallowed and brought a benediction to the buyer. By which means I saw whose purse was best in picture, and what I saw to my good use, I remembered, so that I picked and cut most of their festival purses. And had not the old man come in with a hoo-hoo against his daughter and the king's son, I had not left a purse alive in the whole army.
Nay, but my letters shall clear that doubt.
And those of the court from King Leontes
shall satisfy your father.
Happy be you, all that you speak shows fair.
What have we here? We'll make an instrument of this. Omit nothing that may give us aid?
If they have overheard me now, why, hanging.
How now, good fellow? Why shakest thou so?
Oh, I'm a poor fellow, sir.
Oh, be so still. Here's nobody will steal that from thee. Yet, for the outside of thy poverty, an exchange must be made. Therefore, discase thee instantly, and change garments with this gentleman.
I'm a poor fellow, sir. I know ye well enough.
Nay, pray thee, dispatch.
Are you in earnest, sir? I smell a trick on it.
Dispatch, I pray thee.
Unbuckle, unbuckle. Fortunate mistress, you must muffle your face, dismantle you, and as best you can, disliken the truth of your own seeming, that you may to shipboard get undescribed.
I see the place to lie stands bare apart.
No remedy. Have you done there?
Should I not be my father, you would not call me son.
Nay, you shall have no hat. Come, lady. Come. Farewell, my friend.
Adieu, sir.
Fortune speed us. Let's be set on to the seaside.
The swifter, the speed, the better. What I do now is to tell the king of this escape, and whither they are gone. Wherein my hope is, I shall follow him after, in whose company I shall view Cecilia, for whose sight I have a woman's longing.
I understand the business. I hear it. To have an open ear, a quick eye, and a nimble hand is necessary for a cut purse. A good nose is requisite also, to smell out work for the other senses. I see now that this is the time that the unjust man doth thrive. The prince himself is about a piece of iniquity, stealing away from his father with his clog and his heel. If I thought it were a piece of honesty to acquaint the king withal, I would not do it. Therefore, therein am I constant to my profession.
No other way.
No. Besides, here's more matter for a hot brain. Every lane's end yields a careful man work.
Well, there is no other way but to tell the king she's a changeling and none of your flesh and blood.
Nay, but hear me.
No, hear me.
No, hear me. Listen to me. Me, go to them.
She being none of your flesh and blood, your flesh and blood has not offended the king. Therefore, your flesh and blood is not to be punished by him. Show him those things you found about her, those secret things. That being done, let the law go whistle, I'll warrant you.
Very wisely, puppies.
Well, let's to the king. There's that in this farm will make him scratch his beard.
I know not what impediment this complaint may be to the prince, my master.
Pray heartily he be at the palace.
Oh, though I am not normally an honest man, I am so sometimes by chance. Let me pocket up my peddler's excrement. How now, rustics? Whither are you bound?
To the palace, and it like your worship.
You're the fair now. What? With whom? The condition of that wall? Your name, your nature, the place, your dwelling, anything that is fain to be known in this hour.
Are you a courtier and it like you, sir?
Whether it like me or no, I am a courtier. Seest thou not the air of the court in these enfoldings? Receives not thy nose court odor from me? Reflect I not on thy baseness, court contempt? Ooh. I am a courtier, can't prepare, and one that will either push on or pluck back thy business there. Whereupon I command thee to open thy affair.
My business, sir, is to the king.
Well, what advocate hast thou to him?
I know not, it like you.
Advocate's the court word for a pheasant. Say you have none.
None, sir. I have no pheasant, cock, nor hen.
Blessed are we who are not simple men. Yet nature may have made me as these are. I will not disdain.
This cannot be but a great courtier.
Well, his garments are rich, but he wears them not handsomely.
He seems all the more noble in being fantastical. A great man, I'll warrant.
That funnel there! What's in the funnel? Wherefore that box?
There are such secrets in this fardel and box, sir, that none must know but the king.
Page, thou hast lost thy labor.
Why, sir?
Well, the king is not at the palace. He has gone aboard a new ship to purge melancholy and air himself. For thou must know, the king is full of grief.
daughter.
If that shepherd be not in hand fast, let him fly. Oh, the curses he shall have, the tortures he shall feel, will break the back of man, the heart of monster.
Think you so, sir?
Not he alone shall suffer. Those who are germane to him will all come under the hangman. An old sheep whistling rogue. Into grace. Some say he shall be stoned. That death's too soft for him, say I. Draw thrown into a sheepcote. All deaths are too few. The saw, the sharpest, too easy.
Has the shepherd error? Son, do you hear?
He has a son.
Oh.
Who shall be flayed alive?
Spoke a thousand things that would have done time more benefit and graced your kindness better. You are one of those would have him wed again.
If you would not so, you pity not the state. Consider little what dangers by his highness fail of issue may draw upon his kingdom and devour its uncertain lookers on. What were more holy then for present comfort and future good than to bless a bed of majesty again with a sweet fellow to it?
There is none worthy respecting her that's gone. Besides, has not the divine Apollo said that King Leontes shall not have an heir till his lost child be found? Care not for issue. The crown will find an heir. Great Alexander left his to the worthiest, so his successor was like to be the best.
Good Paulina, that has the memory of Hermione, I go in honor. Oh, that ever I had squared me to thy counsel. Then, even now, I might have looked upon my queen's full eyes, have taken treasure from her lips.
And left them more rich for what they yielded.
Thou speaks truth. No more such wives, therefore, no wife, one worse and better used, would make her sainted spirit again possess her corpse, appear soul vexed, and begin, why to me?
Had she such power, she had just cause.
She had. And would incense me to murder her I married.
I should so. Were I the ghost that walked, I'd bid you mark her eye and tell me for what dull part hence you chose her. Then I shriek that even your ears should rip to hear me, and the words that followed should be, remember mine.
Fear thou, no wife. I'll have no wife, Paulina.
Will you swear never to marry but by my free leave?
Never, Paulina! So be blessed, my spirit.
Then, good my lord, bear witness to his oath.
You tempt him overmuch.
Unless another, as like Hermione as is her picture, affront his eye.
Good madam, I've done.
Yet, if my lord will marry, give me the office to choose you a queen. She shall not be so young as was your former, but she shall be such as walked your first queen's ghost. It should take joy to see her in your arms.
My true Paulina, we shall not marry till thou bidst us.
That will be when your first queen's again in breath. Never till then.
My lord, one that gives out himself Prince Florizel, son of Polixenes, with his princess, she the fairest I have yet beheld, desires access to your high presence.
What with him? His approach, so out of circumstance and sudden, tells us 'tis not a visitation framed, but forced by need and accident. His princess, say you, with him?
Aye, the most peerless piece of earth, I think, that e'er the sun shone bright on.
Oh, Hermione! As every present age doth boast itself above a better gone, so must thy grave give way to what's seen now. Sir, you yourself have said, and writ so, she had not been, nor was not to be, equaled. Thus your verse flowed with her beauty once. 'Tis shrewdly ebbed to say you have seen a better.
Pardon, madam, the one I have almost forgot. Your pardon, the other, when she has obtained your eye, will have your tongue too.
Go, bring them to our embracement. Still, 'tis strange he thus should steal upon us.
Had our prince, jewel of children, seen this hour, he had paired well with his lord. There was not a full month between their births.
Prithee, no more. Cease! Thou knowest he dies to me again when talked of.
They are come.
Your mother was most true to wedlock, prince, for she did print your royal father off, conceiving you. Were I but 21, your father's image is so hid in you, his very heir. Well, I should call you brother, as I did him, and speak of something wildly by us performed before. Most dearly welcome. And your fair princess? Goddess. Oh. Alas. I lost a couple that twixt heaven and earth might thus have stood, forgetting wonder as you, gracious couple, do. And then I lost all mine own folly, the society, amity too of your brave father, whom though buried in misery, I desire my life once more to look on him.
By his command have I here touched Sicilia, and from him give you all greetings that a king and friend can send his brother. But infirmity, which waits upon worn times, hath seized his wish stability. He had himself the lands and waters, twixt your throne and his, measured to look upon you. Whom he loves, he bade me say so. More than all the scepters and those that bear them living.
My brother, good gentleman, the wrongs I've done thee stir afresh within me. Welcome hither, as is the spring to the earth. And has he, too, exposed this paragon to the fearful usage, at least ungentle, of the dreadful Neptune, to greet a man not worth her pains, much less the adventure of her person?
My lord, she came from Lydia.
Where the warlike Smalus, that noble honored lord, is feared and loved?
Most royal sir, from thence, from him whose daughter his tears proclaimed his parting with her. Thence, a softening friendly have we crossed, to execute the charge my father gave me for visiting your highness.
The blessed gods purge all infection from our air whilst you do climb it here. You have a holy father, a graceful gentleman against whose person, so sacred as it is, I have done sin. For which the heavens, taking angry note, have left me issueless. And your father's blessed, as he from heaven merits it with you, worthy his goodness. What might I have been, might I have son and daughter now have looked upon such goodly things as you?
Most noble sir, Bohemia greets you from himself by me, desires you to attach his son, who has fled from his father, from his hopes, and with the shepherd's daughter.
Where's Bohemia? Speak.
Here in your city. I now came from him. I speak amazedly, and it becomes my marvel and my message. To your court, while he was hastening, meets he on the way, the father of the seeming lady and her brother.
Camillo has betrayed me.
Lay it so to his charge. He's with the king, your father.
Camillo?
Camillo, sir. I spoke with him, who now has these poor men in question. Never saw I wretches so quake. They kneel, they kiss the earth, forswear themselves as often as they speak. Bohemia stops his ears and threatens them with diverse deaths in death.
Oh, my poor heavens set spies upon us. We'll not have our contract celebrated.
You are married.
We are not, sir. Nor are we like to be. The stars I see would kiss the valleys first.
My lord, is this the daughter of a king?
She is. When once she is my wife.
That once I see from your good father's speed will come on very slowly. I am sorry you have broken from his liking. And as sorry your choice is not as rich in worth as beauty, that you might well enjoy her.
Dear, look up. Though fortune, visible an enemy, should chase us with thy father, how would it know, John, has she to change our loves?
Beseech you, sir. Remember, since you owe no more to time than I do now, with thought of such affection, step forth, mine advocate. At your request, my father will grant precious things, as trifles.
Would he do so, I'd beg your precious mistress, which he counts but a trifle.
Sir, my liege, your eye hath too much youth in't. Not a month before your queen died, she was more worth such gazes than what you look on now.
I thought of her, even in these looks I made. But your petition is as yet unanswered. I will to your father, your honor, not o'erthrown by your desires. I am friend to them and to you. Upon which errand I now go toward him. Therefore follow me, mark which way I make.
The news.
What's the news?
This news which is called true is called like an old tale.
How goes it now, sir?
Nothing but bonfires. The oracle is fulfilled. The king's daughter is found.
I beseech you, sir.
Beseech you, sir.
bring presents?
Were you there?
I was by it, opening to the fargo.
I heard the old shepherd deliver the letter, how he found it.
Methought I heard the shepherd say, he found the child.
Has the king found his heir?
Most true, if ever truth were pregnant by circumstance.
That which you hear, you'll swear you see.
There's such unity in the proofs.
The mantle of Queen Hermione? Her jewel about the neck of it.
The letters of Antigonus found with it.
Which they know to be his character.
The changes I perceive.
In the king and Camillo?
With very notes of admiration.
They seemed almost to tear the cases of their eyes.
There was speech in their dumbness.
Language in their very gesture.
They looked as they had heard of a world ransom.
Or one destroyed.
A notable passion of wonder appeared in them.
Did you see the meaning of the two kings?
No.
Then you lost the sight which has to be seen, cannot be spoken of.
Has the king found his heir?
The oracle is fulfilled.
The king's daughter is found.
The mantle of Queen Hermione.
The letter to Antigonus.
The majesty of the creature in resemblance of the mother.
The affection of nobleness which nature shows above her breeding.
Proclaims her with all certainty to be the king's daughter.
Such a deal of wonder is broken out within this hour that ballad makers cannot be able to express it.
There you might have beheld one joy crown another, and so in such a manner that it seemed sorrow wept to take leave of him, for their joy weighed in tears.
There was casting up of eyes.
Holding up of hands.
Our king being ready to leap out of himself for joy of his newfound daughter, as if that joy now becomes a lost cries. Oh, thy mother, thy mother.
Then ask Bohemia forgiveness. I never heard of such another encounter which lamed report to follow it, and then res description to do it.
Then embraces his son-in-law.
Now he thanks the old shepherd, which stands by like a weather-bitten conduit of many kings' reigns.
What, pray you, became of Antigonus that carried hence the child?
Like an old tale still.
He was torn to pieces with a bear.
This avouches the shepherd's son.
Who has not only his innocence to justify him,
but a handkerchief and rings of his that Helena knows.
But all the noble combat twixt joy and sorrow was fought in Helena.
She had one eye declined for the loss of her husband, another elevated that the oracle was fulfilled.
She lifted the princess from the earth and so locks her in embracing, as if she would pin her to her heart that she might no more be in danger of losing.
Who was most marble, there changed color.
Some swooned.
All sorrowed.
If all the world could have seen it, the woe had been universal.
The dignity of the acts worth the audience of kings and princes, for by such was it acted.
Are they returned to court?
No.
The princess, hearing of her mother's statue,
which is in the keeping of Helena,
a piece now many years in doing, and now newly performed by that rare Italian master, Romano?
Thither with all greediness of affection are they gone, and there they intend to sup.
Shall we thither and with our company peace the rejoicing?
Who would be thence would have the benefit of access?
Every wink of an eye some new grace will be born.
Had I not the dash of my former life in me, would preferment drop on my head. I brought the old man and his son aboard the prince. I told them I heard them talk of a fardel, and I know not what, but he at the time began to be much seasick. An extremity of weather continuing, this mystery remained undiscovered. But 'tis all one to me. For had I been the finder out of the secret, it would not have relished among my other discredits. Here come those I have done good to against my will.
Say you think me still no gentleman born? You had best say these robes are not gentlemen born. Do! Give me the lie and try whether I am not now a gentleman born.
I know you are now, sir, a gentleman born.
I have been so any time these 4 hours. my brother, and the princess, my sister, called my father, father, and so we wept. There were the first gentleman-like tears we shed.
And we made a son to shed many more.
Or else twere hard luck being in so preposterous an estate as we are.
Well, I humbly beseech you to forgive me the fault I have committed against your worship, and give me your good report to the prince, my master.
Prithee, son, do, for we must be gentle, now we are gentlemen.
Thou wilt amend thy life.
Oh, aye, and it like your worship.
Give me thy hand. I shall swear to the prince that thou art as honest a fellow as any in Bohemia.
Oh, you may say it, but not swear it.
Not swear it? Now I am gentleman born.
How if it be false, son?
If it ne'er be so false, a true gentleman may swear it on behalf of his friend. Mm. And I'll swear to the prince that thou art a tall fellow of thy hands, and that thou wilt not be drunk. But I know that thou art not a tall fellow of thy hands, and that thou wilt be drunk. Would thou wouldst be a tall fellow of thy hands.
I will prove so, sir, best of my power.
By any means, prove to be a tall fellow of thy hands. The king and princes are kindred. Go to see the queen's picture. Come, follow us.
Where?
Huh?
Where shall we go?
Pray, where lives the lady?
It cannot be far where she abides.
Oh, brave and good Paulina, the great comfort I have had of thee.
What, sovereign sir? I did not well. I meant well. All my services you have paid home. But that you have vouchsafed with your crowned brother my poor house to visit, it is a surplus of your grace.
Paulina, we honor you with trouble. But we came to see the statue of our queen. Your gallery and we passed through, but we saw not that which my daughter came to look upon, the statue of her mother.
As she lived, peerless, so her dead likeness, I do well believe, excels whatever yet you looked upon, or hand of man hath done. Therefore, I keep it lonely, apart. But here it is, prepared to see the light, as lively mocked as ever still sleep mocked death. Behold, and say, 'tis well. I like your silence. It the more shows off your wonder. But yet speak. First you, my liege. Comes it not something near?
Her natural posture. But yet, Paulina, Hermione was not so much wrinkled, nothing so aged as this seems.
Oh, not by much.
So much the more our father's excellence, which lets go by some 16 years, and makes her as she lived now.
As now she might have done, so much to my good comfort, as it is now, piercing to my soul. Oh, thus she stood, even with such life of majesty, warm life, as now it coldly stands. When I first wooed her, I am ashamed. Does not the stone rebuke me for being more stone than it?
And give me leave, and do not say to superstition that I kneel and then implore her blessing. My dear queen, that ended when I but began, give me that hand of yours to kiss.
Oh, patience! The statue is but newly fixed. The color is not dry.
Oh, my lord, your sorrows were too sore laid on, which 16 winters cannot blow away so many summers dry. Scarce any joy did ever so long live. No sorrow but cured itself much sooner.
Dear my brother, let him that was the cause of this have power to take off from you so much grief as he will piece up in himself.
Indeed, my lord, had I thought the sight of my poor image would thus have wrought you, I'd not have showed it.
But do not draw the curtain.
No longer shall you gaze on't, lest anon your fancy may think it moves.
Let me. What was he that didn't make it? See, my lord, would you not deem it breathed? And that those veins did verily their blood masterly done, the very life seems warm upon her lip, the fixture of her eye of motion is...
I'll draw the curtain. My lord's so far transported, he'll think anon it lives.
Oh, sweet Paulina, make me to think so 20 years together. No settled senses of the world could match the pleasure of that madness.
I am sorry, sir, that I have thus far stirred you, but I could afflict you farther.
Do, Paulina, for this affliction hath a taste as sweet as any cordial comfort. Still, methinks there is an air comes from her. What fine chisel could ever yet cut breath?
Let no man mock me. I will kiss her.
Oh, good, my lord, forbear. The readiness upon her lip is wet. You'll mar it if you kiss it. Stain your own with oily painting. Shall I draw the curtain?
No, not these 20 years.
So long could I stand by and look her on.
Either forbear, quit presently the chapel, or resolve you for more amazement. If you can behold it, I'll make the statue move. Indeed, descend and take you by the hand. But then you'll think, which I protest against, I am assisted by wicked powers.
What you can make her do, I am content to look on. What to speak, I am content to hear.
It is required you do awake your faith. Then all stand still. Or those that think it is unlawful business I am about, let them depart.
Proceed. No foot shall stir.
Music. Awake her. Strike. 'Tis time. Descend. Be stone no more. Approach. I'll fill your grave up. Stir! Nay, come away! Bequeath to death your numbness, for from him dear life redeems you! Oh. You perceive she stirs. Start not. Her action shall be as holy as you hear my spell is lawful. Do not shun her until you see her die again, for then you kill her double. Nay, present your hand. When she was young, you wooed her. Now in age, is she become the suitor?
Oh, she's warm.
She embraces him.
She hangs about his neck. If she pertain to life, let her speak too.
Aye, and makes manifest where she has lived or how stolen from the dead.
That she is living, were it but told you, would be hooted at like an old tale. But it appears she lives, though yet she speak not.
Art thou alive? Or is it fantasy that plays upon our eyesight? I prithee speak. We will not trust our eyes without our ears.
Please you to interpose, fair madam. Kneel and pray your mother's blessing. Turn, good lady. Our Perdita is found. You gods look down, and from your sacred vials pour your graces upon my daughter's head. Oh, tell me, my own, where hast thou been preserved? Where lived? How found thy father's court? For thou shalt hear that I, knowing by Paulina that the oracle gave hope thou wast in being, have preserved myself to see the issue. This time enough for that. Lest they desire upon this push to trouble your joys with like relation. Oh, go together, you precious winners all. that's never to be found again. Lament till I am lost.
Oh, peace, Paulina. Go not from us thus, I pray you carry.
My lord, I would not lose you. Therefore, forbear a while. I do confess I have more care to stay than will to go.
Stay a while. Thou shalt not go so soon. What? Oh, look on my brother. Both your pardons, that e'er I put between your holy looks my ill suspicion. This is your son-in-law, and son unto the king, whom heaven's directing is frostlike to your daughter. Good Paulina, lead us from hence, where we may leisurely each one demand an answer to his part performed in this wide gap of time since first we were dissevered. Hastily, lead away.